In my last video where I made this sled for cutting wood turning segments, I showed this bowl and it got a lot of comments wanting to see how I made it. So I thought, hey, it'd be fun to make another one, so that's what I'm doing today. But actually that would be super boring, so I'm gonna make it a little bit different. You can see here I tried to make a basket weave pattern, but being only two layers high, it doesn't look quite right. So on the bowl I'm gonna make today, I'm gonna go four layers high. And instead of these vertical strips being actually vertical, they're going to be at a 20 degree angle, just for something a little different. I actually forgot to mention in the sled video that this sled works on both sides of the blade. I need a stop block so that I can get all the segments the right length, so I'm going to use this 20 pound chunk of steel as my stop block.
I like to do it this way just because the steel is easy and precise, and the fence is there just to keep it from getting shoved away.
The segments cut off the front of the fence and the segments cut off the back of the fence are beveled in opposite directions, so they can't be used in the same bowl. The only practical way to use these is to make two separate bowls. Keeping them in order and in the correct orientation is important because we need to have continuous grain all the way around the bowl. See, if this were a basket weave, there would be a continuous strip of wood all the way around. So it's important that this looks like a continuous strip, even though it's not. And as you can see, it doesn't make any difference that these are beveled. They still make a perfect ring. And now I can just simply spread these apart and put these pieces in between. And there you can see the beginning of my basket weave pattern. Gluing this up is going to be quite a pain because I can't just put a band around it and squeeze it, or all the segments will go. So I'm just going to do each joint one at a time by hand. My first thought was to just work my way around, but the problem is with these angled outsides, things are kind of skewed and there's nothing to line up to. So chances are by the time I get all the way around, I'm going to have some error. As you can see here, I don't want to end up with that problem when all these joints are glued. So I taped all of the segments together, front and back, and I've made sure that they're where I want them. And now I'm going to take off the tape from two opposing joints, and then I can put these segments in those two joints by doing these across from each other, letting these dry and then doing a couple more and a couple more. Hopefully when I'm all done, I don't end up with any errors. About a minute or two of holding this will be very, very strong. Now just don't touch that for a while. Well, I got one ring done, and I have three more to go. You already saw how I did it, so I think I'm just gonna turn off the camera and they're all done. I need to flatten these out so I can glue them together, so I'm gonna use my drum sander for that. Supposedly 36 grit doesn't work very well in drum sander. I think that might be why they say 36 grit's not a good idea, but it did a pretty good job of taking down the excess of this. So I sanded all of these up to 80 grit, so they're smooth enough to glue, and they're nice and flat. I'm just hot gluing some little pieces onto here, and that'll keep the alignment right when I go to glue it up. The wood glue is gonna try to make them slip around. Done. Now by itself this basket weave would look kind of unfinished. I'm gonna cap off the top and bottom with a walnut ring. I have a method for making the grain line up perfectly all the way around the ring. If you imagine this being the board, and I've cut all these segments out, if I wrap this up, the grain lines up perfectly all the way around until here, and then we have about a quarter inch error. So this is not the way to do it. The walnut that I'm using is twice as thick as I need the ring to be. That's important, and you'll see why in a little bit. I cut it to the width that I want the ring to be, so that'll go just like that. Take note of how I'm cutting these. I'm only cutting full segments off the front of the sled. Off the back, I'm just cutting off enough to make the angle right. So now these will be able to wrap up like so, and the grain will line up perfectly. Right now I'm only making 6 of these, and I will turn them into 12. And now I just need to glue up the half ring. So I'll just put these all in order and tape them together. Now the important thing is that these two surfaces will be flat relative to each other. So I'm just applying as much force as I need to make these two joints straight in line with each other. As I showed earlier, it's easy to make a partial ring with perfectly aligned grain, but where the two ends meet, that's where your problem is. But if we mirror that, now we have perfectly aligned grain all the way around. Mirroring is basically book matching. So I'm gonna book match this piece. I don't want to apply too much force or it could break the ring. Now I'm just gonna sand this all down and see how well the grain lines up. So from a distance, this looks pretty good. But if you look up close, you'll see that I made a mistake. In the wood that I used, the grain is angled across the end. So then when I took the bandsaw and cut a kerf out of there, that made that grain misalign because some of the material was removed. I really should have used a piece of wood with vertical grain so that even though I took out that bandsaw kerf, the grain would still line up. So I'm doing the same thing for the bottom, except this time, since the segments all come to a point, the keepers and offcuts are exactly the same. So that means I can make 2 separate rings out of the one board. This will be the final glue up. These 2 plywood discs are just for mounting it on the lathe. Now I'm really wishing that I had glued down some tabs to hold these in place like I did for the other rings. I made this really heavy-duty faceplate. I think that should help to reduce chatter on bowl turnings like this. Ready to turn it. I wanted this bowl to be as big as would fit on the lathe, but it looks like I'm actually gonna have to do a little bit of sanding there. So this is definitely the max for this lathe, but I think it's gonna work. I've got the outside rough turned so it's round, and I'm going to go ahead and move to turning the inside. I don't want to get this too thin before I rough turn the inside because I might get some catches in there. I think I'm done with the outside. Now I just need to turn the inside so that I have a consistent wall thickness. I made this little tool for measuring wall thickness. It's just a piece of plywood. There's a screw right here, straight across from a dial indicator. So it's a very simple thickness gauge. So right there we're at about 5/8. Right there it's 3/4. Right there we're up to 7/8. I'm gonna try to go to about 3/8 inch. Well, the turning is all done, so now I just have a ton of sanding to do. This plywood really benefits from being sanded in every possible direction. It's the only way to really get it smooth, otherwise you always end up with a little bit of a, well, sandpaper feel. I don't have a way to rechuck the bolt, so I can't turn it around and finish the bottom. That's actually why I put two pieces of plywood on here, to give me enough thickness that I can get in there with a parting tool and start to create a slight concave in the bottom. So that way it'll sit on just a rim. And then after I start creating that concave, I'll go ahead and part it off completely and finish the concave by hand after it's off the lathe. In order to get a tool rest that reaches, I had to grab me a broken 1-inch bolt and a couple scraps of steel and weld them together. So right there you can see the concave, and right there that's the rim that's going to sit on the table. So I've cut pretty much as far as I can with this, and now I'm just going to take a saw and break it off. So now I just have the rest of this to remove. Well, that was a lot of work to finish it that way, but I have to say, for not rechucking it, that actually worked really well. Time for some finish. I'm using this Clapham's beeswax solid bowl finish. I'm not sure if this is the ideal finish for the job, but it's made by a small family-run business in British Columbia, and that's the kind of businesses I like to support.